Political Science Department of Michigan State University. I've only known Professor Weinberger for a couple of years, but he has been a looming presence on the periphery of my consciousness for a long time. Specifically, whenever I ran across people who really could speak interestingly about the relationship of science and politics and the political character of scientific thought, and some of you will recall, for example, our old colleague and recent Bradley lecturer, Charles Rubin, they would always tell me, well, of course you've got to talk to or read Weinberger about that. He's got a really interesting reading of whatever it was. His book, Science, Faith, and Politics, Francis Bacon and the Utopian Roots of the Modern Age, and the many articles on the early modern origins, as well as the contemporary critique of the scientific liberal revolution, were, for those I respected, basic and necessary reading to understand the complex and vital issues they canvassed. When at a conference a couple of years ago, I finally got to meet this by now thoroughly awesome figure, I was relieved and delighted to find out that in addition to being the great and cited Weinberger, he is also an engaging and witty lecturer and a sensitive and insightful questioner. He will talk to us tonight, and then he will answer questions, and then we'll all go out and see if there's anything left to nibble on. And he will talk to us tonight about something with the academic sounding title of Heidegger's Legacy, Technology and Democratic Politics, but which I suspect is something more in the nature of a time bomb that is running out of picks, Professor Weinberger. Thank you for that introduction. I'd like to remind you that in our nihilistic age, according to Heidegger, and according to the language of my teenage daughter, the word awesome applies to such things as bubble gum, rock musicians, minor things. So. Of the Great Revolution in Eastern Europe and the Soviet Union, Vaclav Havel, writer and intellectual, dissident and hero of the democratic movement, and president of what was then Czechoslovakia, was invited to address a joint session of the United States Congress. He came, and his speech was widely noted. In his speech celebrating the collapse of socialism and communist tyranny, Havel made an extraordinary remark. To the assembled legislators, he said that Martin Heidegger was the most important thinker for him and for the new generation of free post-communist East Europeans. By implication, Havel certainly meant that the same thing was true for his listeners, that Heidegger, not Locke or Mill or Jefferson or Lincoln, is the thinker who most illuminates our time, who most explains to us the meaning of the new dawn of liberty in the world. Now, the comment was, of course, ridiculously naive. Probably no one in the chamber had ever heard of Martin Heidegger, much less actually ever read him. One can readily imagine an aging senator whispering to a doubtless young and good-looking staffer, get me a two-paragraph memo on this Heidegger fellow. Now, our mature democracy is rather far removed from the cultured heyday of our founding.
which is at least one reason why the intellectuals all found Vaclav Havel so very charming. But the comment he made was also both ominous and not far off the mark. Ominous because Heidegger, touted mentor of the new age of freedom, had been a Nazi and had declared that there is no real difference between the democratic and the communist systems, since both are in the distorting grasp of technology. Ominous too, because Heidegger had attacked, at least apparently, the very principles upon which democracy as we know it have been based. The Enlightenment principles of human rights, individualism, and the ideal of a rational society founded on the scientific conquest of nature. His remark was not far off the mark, because it's true that Heidegger is the most powerful force behind the intellectual culture of our present time. Despite his notorious difficulties and the now admitted bad odor of his politics, Heidegger's ideas simply permeate recent thinking in the West. And this despite their being completely alien to our habitual ways of thinking about basic questions of philosophy and morality and politics. Everywhere, in the universities, in the general intellectual culture, even on the talk show, we hear constantly of the dawn of a postmodern, post-rationalist age, of an age beyond metaphysics, beyond the myths of the subject and the individual, beyond all foundations and totalities, and so on. Feminists, multiculturalists, the proponents of the new identity politics, and certainly all and many of those who would reinterpret democracy and liberalism all seem to think that much, indeed everything, depends on freeing ourselves from the principles of Enlightenment rationalism. Never have arcane critical ideas seemed to matter so much to so many. For they show us that the old ideas and ideals that brought us to our present situation, the global triumph of liberal democracy, are really the sources of injustice and oppression as we now know them. Havel perhaps knew exactly what he was talking about. For the real source of the arcane new critical ideas is Heidegger. No matter how far their proponents stray from his intentions and his genuine depth, it's reasonable then to take Havel seriously, as his listeners in Congress probably certainly did, and to try to come to grips with Heidegger. Now, few of those who were so deeply influenced by Heidegger have taken the time to read and come to grips with his most important and first major book, Being and Time, and who can blame them? The Heidegger that has been most often read is the later Heidegger, whose writings are more accessible and less technically difficult than works like Being and Time or Fundamental Principles of Phenomenology. A predominant theme of those later writings is technology, which for Heidegger was the dominant fact of our time and the key to understanding the history and legacy of Western thought and culture. Now, I can't begin to explain Heidegger's philosophy as a whole, first of all, because I'm not sure that I could, or to describe the argument of Being in Time in any detail that would do it justice. So I'll try to give you some idea of what's at stake by focusing on his argument about technology, and then try to relate it briefly to some trends in contemporary democratic and liberal thinking. Now, a good way to get a handle on Heidegger's view of technology is to begin with his strange comment. All of his comments have a certain air of strangeness about them. Is to come to grips with his comment in an essay entitled The Question Concerning Technology, that the essence of technology is nothing technological. An almost famous remark now by Heidegger. By this, he meant several things. First, what is important about technology is not the sum of machines and techniques that comprise it. We could study machines and the sciences that produce them, he says, until hell freezes over and not know anything about the essence of technology. The second point that he's making is that what's important about technology is not the problem of unintended consequences or the need to get machines under our control. In Heidegger's view, it isn't possible for us to get these machines and their effects under our control, because every attempt to do so is, he thought, accomplished from a technological point of view. This view is so pervasive, he thought, that it even frames how we think of technology as a phenomenon and respond to it as a problem. Think of the word environmental. Environmentalism and the environment. I mean, that understands nature as that which surrounds us and for which we somehow are responsible. And to Heidegger, that would be 100% in the frame of technological thinking. Finally, and this is the most important point he's trying to make, by far the most important point. But technology as a whole is not something we can comprehend with the familiar categories we use to think about things. From the usual point of view, according to him, we would answer the question, what is technology, with the following kind of answer. Well, to be human is to be rational, which means, among other things, to order means to ends. And that's what technology is. From the simplest hunter's bow to the most complicated computer, technology is a rational means to a human end. Thus, the history of technology is simply the working out of the nature of the human animal, the animal endowed with freedom and rational agency. As Rousseau said in the Discourse on Inequality, a bird will starve next to a food to which its instinct does not compel it, while a human will be free and able to choose 1,000 ways to satisfy its basic needs. So technology, according to this traditional view, is simply a predicate of the subject, human thing, along with other predicates such as rational, featherless, biped, and so on. Now, on this latter standard view of technology, according to Heidegger, it follows that technology is simply coeval with human life. Every human society has its arts, and what we see today is just the logical and historical development of this fact. And yet, he wanted to point out, and I think he would say it's clear to anybody with eyes to see, there's something completely wrong here. Something that technology itself shows us. For our world is surely different from the Greek or the primitive world. And modern technology surely differs radically from its ancient counterparts or its primitive counterparts. Ancient technology was not all pervasive in the way that modern technology seems to be. It did not color every aspect of life, from sex to thinking, from religious worship to politics, from family life to business, from art to recreation, our lives literally from the cradle to the grave. Imagine a modern university president congratulating new graduates on their successful acquisition of the knowledge of how to die well. Imagine Aristotle's gentleman or Socrates' students being exhorted to the conquest as opposed to the contemplation of nature. Imagine a Greek shoemaker or sculptor thinking that his craft depends on and expresses the mathematical science of matter in motion. No, modern technology is something altogether new. If so, Heidegger continues, then it cannot be an essential predicate of the subject thing human. And yet it's doubtless a human phenomenon. No other living thing exhibits it. So what do we conclude from thinking about technology, according to Heidegger? Ultimately this, that the human entity, the human being is not a thing as we usually think about things, in terms of having essences and predicates, in terms of having a nature, in terms of defining causes, in terms of genus and species, or in terms of any of the various categories of Western science and philosophy. Technology, according to him, has the power to make us think about technology. It brings itself into focus as something quite peculiar, and as such a peculiar thing, it has this strange power to show us who we really are. And yet, why does modern technology scare us if it shows us who we are? If it, you know, clarifies our self-understanding? Well, not really because it tempts us to pride or overreaching, but because we fear its power to deform and transform us. We fear it because of its power to dehumanize, to treat us as mere objects or things, which, of course, it really can do. Think of the baleful implications of such abstract and technological terms as management science, human resources, communication, and interfacing, to name just a few. We think of technology as out of control, not just because it has a life of its own, but because in principle, on the basis of its scientific grounds, it cannot tell the essential differences between a human being and any other object of nature. So for Heidegger, modern technology is twofold and contradictory. Okay? It reflects a way of thinking based on what he calls metaphysics, and ultimately technology, that covers up and distorts what human life really is. And therefore, it covers up, he says, what there is in the world. It covers up the unity and the multiplicity of being. At the same time, however, it announces, both in its novelty and uniqueness, and in the way that it scares us, that human beings are not entities to be understood in the categories used to grasp the objects of natural science. It thus prepares the way, according to him, for a more genuine encounter with what we are, and therefore with what nature is, and with what the phenomenon of the world is. To use Heidegger's poetic formulation, borrowed from the poet Hölderlin, he says, where technology reigns, there is danger in the highest sense, danger that it will destroy human beings. But where the danger is, grows the saving power also, i.e., this thing that threatens to destroy us is the sole power in the modern age that shows us the way to see and understand what human life really is. So Heidegger, for all of his attacks on technology, was no simple-minded critic of it. On the contrary, he thought it was a pretty good thing. Now, let me try to spell all this out in a little more detail so that we can understand what's going on. But please remember that I'm here presenting just a very simple outline or sketch and nothing approaching the argument in its depth and detail. It's usually thought, under the influence of philosophic positivism, that modern science has nothing to do with metaphysics, which, unlike the sciences, and especially mathematical physics, deals with airy figments of the imagination. But Heidegger argues just the contrary, that modern science and technology are rooted ultimately in the ontology of the metaphysical worldview. And this worldview, although it got its distinctively modern cast in the philosophy of Descartes, goes all the way back to Plato. Now, according to classical and medieval ontology, the basic ways that anything is there are two basic ways that everything that is. Essence which answers the question of what something is, and existence, which answers the question of whether or how something is. Existence is understood as extantness, or actuality, the fact that something is actually set over against us as a thing or object which can be presented to us as a knowable or graspable thing. According to this ontology of the classics and the medieval, a thing, an existing what, is an abiding or sitting still thing, something that sits still. It isn't coming or going. It's not changing. It is what he calls a presence at hand. Now, the ancients certainly spoke at length about the soul and about the relationship between the being of things and the activity of the mind. But they didn't grasp the essence of the human things because they understood them in terms of extant and present at hand things. As if a human being were a thing that stands unmoved and complete against or across from a knower, i.e. that same human thing. Now, according to modern metaphysics, which is indebted, of course, to Descartes, and out of which grew our science and technology, according to Heidegger, the basic ways of being are again two. There's nature, res extensa, and mind, res cogitans, extended substance, thinking substance. The relation between them is traditionally understood so that to be something is to be knowable, and what is knowable is interpreted to mean what is ascertainable with mathematical, numerical certainty. According to Descartes, the mind or the subject is what is known with the most immediate and indubitable certainty. So it is the key, so to speak, to our grasp of what is in the world. The subject thus comes to the fore in modern philosophy. It's the topic of modern philosophy, unlike in ancient philosophy, according to Heidegger, where the thing against standing over against the subject was always the topic. But the subject never gets clarified, he says, much less grasped correctly, because the ancient ontology of what and that, essence and existence, is still at work. Both subject and object are understood in terms of extantness or presence at hand, as if both things and human beings can only be when they're brought to a stand, when they sit still, when there's no way of describing them as in motion somehow. Or in the specifically modern sense, entrapped as calculable in the mathematical formula. Now, what's missing, according to Heidegger, in both ancient and modern metaphysics, and so therefore in modern technology, is the character of human being. By this, Heidegger does not mean the sphere of human value, or something mushy and soft like that. Heidegger is no humanist at all, at least as we understand that term. Rather, he just means that metaphysics, all modern thinking prior to his own, dogmatically assumes one thing to be like another, when in fact, they're not. Or to put it somewhat differently, and in his terms, metaphysics mistakenly interprets the various domains of being, and so being itself, in terms of just one domain. For metaphysics, he says, one size fits all. To think of humans as extant subjects, as things with a nature, according to him, covers up the radical openness of human life. To think of human beings as subjects who must get out to and understand the world in order to live in it, or who spontaneously determine its transcendental conditions and in addition act as free moral wills, both of those we see in Kant, all this covers up the fact that we always live quite well in any world before we ever come to wonder what it is. or even before we ever come to know anything about it. And it leaves unexamined the kind of being that might be the transcendental ground of objects in the Kantian transcendental sense, or free moral agents in the Kantian moral sense. All of these tendencies of thought, which stretch from Plato to Kant, cover up what Heidegger calls the phenomenon of the world. Now, I can't possibly begin to explain this account of the world as it's worked out in Being and Time and the other works published just after it, so I'll try to present just a very brief story, and I hope it's reasonably clear. Our everyday common sense tells us that the world is made up of objects that surround us. Objects like nature, tools, the stars, the sky, and each one of these things has both whatness and existence, or extantness. The Greeks called the connected whole of these things the cosmos, and it too has a what and a whether, an essence and an existence. The world provides us with our place. It's what we're in. You know, you look around and you're inside this thing, the world. It gives us our sense of orientation and being, as we see in such quaint references as the things above, the things below, and the things in between. That was what Socrates was accused of having delved into, you know, top and bottom and the middle. The world, therefore, somehow tells us where we are and who we are. And then the world is either eternal or made and ordered by the one thing that is eternal. So metaphysics, he says, in all of its forms, in one way or the other, takes this basic conception of the world for granted, even if it doesn't acknowledge it. It really assumes it. Heidegger says that this is a gigantic and an age-old mistake. Consider any object that's in the world, a thing of nature, for instance, or a tool. How can it at once comprise or make up the world and yet be in it? If we think about any such object, according to him, we discover that the world is the clearing in which these things appear. But the world is not itself a collection of such things, these intra-worldly things like rocks and trees and classrooms and all that. So what is the world? Rather, the world, he says, is the web of human practices and doings that forms the horizon within which all things can appear. Human beings are not inside the world. Only non-human things are. Human beings, on the contrary, are what he calls being in the world with hyphens, by which Heidegger means something like this. Human beings are the bearers of the familiar meaning contexts in which the various non-human objects are met up with as objects. Human beings are not in the world, in the sense of inside it. Their doings are, for want of a better term, the worlding that gives location to non-human things. Human beings thus have no place in the sense imagined by common sense and metaphysics. Human being is the place for all the non-human things that are. Human beings don't have a place, they are place. That's what he's saying. Now, I could work this out in much greater detail, but I don't think I can do that now. But suffice it to say that this account of the world is certainly very disconcerting. It utterly destroys our comforting sense of location and place and orientation. It destroys our sense of what we are and to what we belong. It means that our way of being is not like the way of being of natural objects. Human beings can't be understood in terms of the categories we use to grasp these objects, such as essence and actuality, and genus and species, formal, material, efficient, and cause, and final cause, and so forth. According to Heidegger's full analysis, this account of the world discloses the uncanny fact of human indeterminateness or openness and finitude. It discloses the genuine face of human death. No wonder, then, that it is so often and so long overlooked, even though this phenomenon of the world is really right under our noses, so to speak. We're familiar with it in a kind of unconscious way when we brush our teeth and walk across the room and open the door. And to emphasize that point, the analysis in which Heidegger presents this unveiling of the world in the first half of Being and Time, and in the third chapter or section of Fundamental Problems of Phenomenology, his account of this is based on no fancy or abstract preconception or no arcane conceptual apparatus. Rather, his account of the world proceeds by explicitly eschewing all theoretical and philosophical preconceptions. It proceeds by examining as close as possible our average everyday activities, the doing that we engage in, the various doings that we engage in, so immediately that we look right past them as we go, such as using a tool in a workshop. Now, according to Heidegger, the metaphysical cover-up of our own worldly character gets its particular forms from one of the activities that takes up most of our lives from day to day, artful production. It's no accident, he says, that Aristotle's ethics begins with a lot of talk about the productive arts, or that Plato's Republic is modeled on the productive arts. In fact, he says, the basic concepts of Greek ontology take their cue from the everyday activity of artful making. In the Basic Problems of Phenomenology, Heidegger explains the productive or productionist foundations of metaphysical concepts, of the Greek metaphysical concepts, by analyzing the Greek notion of eidos, the looks of a thing. According to Heidegger, when the Greeks thought about the being of anything, they thought of its essence, which they understood to be the eidos, or the looks of a thing. Those of you who've read Plato's Republic know that that's the whole object of philosophic investigation, to grasp the eide. And that, of course, is a word that has this double sense. It means this fancy, abstract philosophic notion about the essence of a thing, and on the other hand, it just means what something looks like. You know, it's face. When the Greeks thought about the being of a thing, he says they understood it as eidos, or looks. And in the look of a thing, where he says, in the look of a thing, we are able, according to the Greeks, to see what it is, its thingness, the peculiar character impressed on it. Now, if we take a thing as it is encountered in perception, in just looking at something rather than making it, okay, then the look of something, Heidegger says, is based on the form, or morphe. But Plato did not use the term morphe, and did not use the term eidos lightly. For him, the look is not grounded on the form, but vice versa. Any existing thing, this, has the form that it does because of the eidos of that thing. Its look that is, you know, according to him, way up in the sky somewhere. It's an intelligible thing. It doesn't have body. For him, then, the look is not grounded on the form, but vice versa. Okay? And this is possible only if we take production rather than looking at something or perception as the guiding clue to the interpretation of what things are, what it means for anything to be. When a thing is made, say a clay pot, the looks, the finished product, has always been imagined beforehand. It comes before the existing thing. And Heidegger points out in great detail, that's how people came to think in ancient metaphysics that an actual thing is but an image of the real thing that always comes before the actual thing. right? In other words, if there are Platonic idae, if there are these eternal forms, then they were in existence before Plato was alive and before any potter made the pot, okay? And that's because, of course, in production, he's saying, the idea of what you want precedes the form. So the looks have always been imagined beforehand. The actual shaped product is both matter and form, but the matter gets the form that it has according to the anticipated look, the eidos, that was always already there before any actualizing takes place. And that's how people can say that, in a way, possibilities prior to actuality and all of the complicated conundrums of classical and medieval ontology. Thus, for Greek ontology, and this goes, he says, both for Aristotle as for Plato, despite their big differences on some of these issues, the notion of what it means for anything to be was read off from the activity of making things that surround us in our everyday activities. Okay? Our philosophy, our way of understanding what the whole world is, was simply read off from this everyday fact of productive life. The concept of physis, or nature, was read off in exactly the same way. A natural object is just a thing that produces itself, rather than something that gets produced by something else. Now, according to him, the Greeks thought that despite being made by us, the products of art once made, and thus released by making, stand on their own, just as do the things of nature. They stand before us, he says, and in the closest circle of human activity, they do so as ready for use. Nature too stands against us ready for use. Wind, sun, sky, night, day. You know, take the, you know, how does the naive, simple conception of nature occur? The wind is what blows the sails. The sun is what lights the day. The night is what tells you to go to sleep. The day is what makes you get up and go to work, and so forth. So the whole of nature is understood as somehow, in this naive way, understood that things stand against us on their own, but nevertheless ready for use. It was this standing before, complete and fixed and ready to become handy, that makes a thing, a what. It's what makes it an eidos that is actual. To be anything, then, is to be a what and to be a stand. And then he points out further, this is a really split argument, since all production requires some stuff that comes first, that is unproduced, the notion of pre-existing matter, and even the notion of a cosmos that is unproduced, is contained in the structure of productive comportment. At the outset of Western ontology, then, the interpretation of being as exhausted by essence and extantness, and the idea that the world is a whole of causally related objects, of extant essences, was read off from the human doing that is the most immediate and close in everyday life. Producing and using. With this, according to Heidegger, the genuine character of human being in the world was closed off from thought and human experience, because human beings were understood on exactly the same model, as if being used and ready for use was the same thing as using. Now, this provenance of metaphysics does not mean that Western thought at the beginning, among the Greeks, was technological from the outset. To be an object still meant something completely different for the Greeks than for us, even if it's true that both cover up human life and the world. For ancient ontology, to be an object was to be hypokaimenon, that which lies before the gaze, this is to quote Heidegger, which lies before the gaze and gathers together all that makes a particular thing a thing. Now, this connection, according to him, does not do violence to things. It only did violence to the truth about human life. That objects were available for use, that nature was understood as available for use, did not mean that we command nature. It was rather understood that nature is home for human beings. So the technological character of the metaphysics, or the technological character of ancient anthropology, the productionist character of ancient ontology rendered it technological only to this extent. That the world is useful insofar as it's a good place for us, but certainly not useful in the same way as understood by modern technology. Even so, it did cover up human being and the world, although it did not reduce all the domains of being to just one. The ancients could still tell the difference between God, say, and a human being and a natural object. But this term, hypokaimenon, came to later be understood as subject, a different interpretation, with man, human being, being the only real subject. As we see in Descartes, it is the subjectivity of the subject, the subject's immediate self-certainty, that is the key to the reality of the world. Whatever is what can be grasped after the manner of human self-grasping. As Heidegger says in The Age of the World Picture, an essay that I would recommend you read, it's very short and clear. He says, man, Heidegger didn't write when we don't say such things anymore, so please forgive me. Man becomes that being upon which all that is grounded as regards the manner of its being and its fruit. Man becomes the relational center of that which is as such. What is becomes what is represented to knowledge. Okay? Not in the sense of being freed or released to be what it is, but in the sense of ordering or being ordered or set up in numerical-mathematical relations. The hypokaimenon has gone from being something that stands by itself as released by art or physis, nature, to what is challenged and set upon as always ready to give itself up to the will to power. This, he says, is an essential and epoch-making difference in the way things are revealed to be. With modern thought, metaphysics becomes mastery of nature. To be becomes, or now comes to mean, to be orderable, to be manipulable. Everything that is just that and nothing else. And so everything that is becomes what Heidegger calls Bestand, standing reserve. By this he means that everything becomes taken to be what is usefully ordered for the sake of useful ordering. To put it in other words, the world and all the things in it, all the things that are, come to be taken as a gigantic gas tank, an enormous reserve of power. He says modern physics sees nature as a vast storehouse of power. It is, therefore, technological in its very essence. In other words, technology isn't the application of science, according to Heidegger. Science, from its beginning, was always technological because it had an ontology. It understood the world and what it meant for anything to be in this technological sense, as he understands it. As the queen of the modern sciences, modern physics, he says, determines ultimately the ontology of all the other sciences, including the social and human sciences such as anthropology and psychology, and so on. So in the modern age, all the domains of being, everything, objects of knowledge, tools, human beings, the earth, the heavens, the gods, are all taken as so much manipulable stuff, Bestand, the standing reserve of power for the sake of power. Now, for Heidegger, the crucial fact about technology is the contradiction we mentioned earlier. Technology embodies modern humanism and subjectivism, yes. The notion that the human animal is the orderer and is the measure of all things. But as technology comes to a fevered pitch in our time, he said, we come to see that technology is, in the crucial respect, not what we do or do not do, not what some subject does, it's rather what's happening to us. By this he grasped that sense of, try to imagine the world simply giving up, you know, modern technology, just reverting to ancient Athens. That's close to unthinkable, okay? So technology can actually come to be thought of as something not that we're doing, but that is happening to us. And this needn't be, by the way, the argument of some lunatic environmentalist. Heidegger couldn't have cared anything about such things. He just said, that's what this phenomenon shows us. Okay? It doesn't make it good or bad, it's just what it is. Moreover, technology is something altogether new. It has not always happened. It's not an essential predicate of the entity human, even though it is a human phenomenon. So a proper grasp of technology reveals something crucial about human life. Human beings are entities through which occurs the various and the changeable ways that things are revealed. Technology reveals beings as Bestand. Medieval ontology revealed beings as created things by God. Ancient ontology meant liberated things standing out and ready for use. And so there are these different ways, radically different ways, in which the being of things is revealed. So technology reveals things as Bestand, as standing reserve, as stuff, as power stuff, gas tank, but at the same time, technology reveals that it is a revealing that happens to us. We're not doing the revealing. Technology is doing the revealing. We're the vehicle for that, not the other way around. As he says in the question concerning technology, since man drives technology forward, he takes part in ordering, i.e. ordering things, lining them up, making them sit still and wait for our filling up the gas tank. Since man drives technology forward, he takes part in ordering as a way of revealing things. But the way of revealing things itself, within which this ordering unfolds, is never a human handiwork. Modern technology as an ordering, revealing, is nothing human. It's no human doing. It is a challenging of man that gathers man into ordering the real as standing reserve. It's basically something like a dispensation of whatever being is, or whatever the ultimate source of things is. Hard to say what that is, but that's what it is. He calls this challenging the Gestell, the enframing. And he says of it that it is a way of revealing that holds sway in us, and therefore it's nothing technological. It's not a tool, it's a way things are revealed. According to Heidegger, then, technology comes to reveal to human beings what human being really is. It's the worlding that reveals things in changeable ways that they appear throughout the history of human life. We do not choose our worlding. It happens to us as a destiny from a source that is utterly mysterious. Technology thus reveals the truth, or a kind of truth, about human life and the character of the world. And thus it makes it possible, when it's grasped correctly, that human life will be experienced apart from the distorting lenses of metaphysics and technology. Technology as a danger gives us the nihilistic age in which everything is the same. Okay? In such an age, the phenomena of art and politics and the gods, he says, are flattened in being understood as mere standing reserve. I mean, think about God. I mean, in a technological sense, we think God is a value, right? a value is projected by human beings, and you can trade in values. You can put them on and take them off, like you get tired of a coat, and so on. Okay? And you can certainly sell values and commercialize them and do all kinds of great things with values. So in such an age, genuine creativity and reverence and loyalty and rootedness and all the full possibilities of astonishment and estrangeness are obliterated, he said, in a relativistic and cybernetic swirl that spares nothing. In this age, there's no real difference between the competing social and political systems, because all are bound together in the embrace of technology. But technology as a savior lights up the genuine character of what we are and all the other things that are and being as such. And this then, he says, makes it actually possible for human beings to come to a genuine relation to what, or rather, who they are. It actually makes it possible for us to see through the obfuscations and dodges and dogmatics of metaphysics. It thus opens the way for genuine human freedom, the freedom to comport resolutely and without blinking to the finitude, the fatedness, and the strangeness of human being and the world, and to anticipate new ways, impossible now to predict, in which things will one day be revealed when the Gestell of technology has taken its leave. Now, at this point, one certainly wants to ask, what on earth does all of this have to do with democratic politics? Well, at least for Heidegger, nothing very good, because he argued that modern democracy was technological through and through, and therefore that it could harbor none of the liberating possibilities of post-technological and post-metaphysical time. In other words, technology will bring democracy to a close at the moment that technology shows us what technology can really show. Because modern democratic politics lives and dies by the technological point of view. Okay. And in that, I think he's sort of right. I mean, if you think about, if you study the sort of theoretical foundations of liberal democracy, I think it's really fair to say that the founders were right, that liberal democracy is unthinkable apart from the expanding standards of liberty. Does anybody know what the only right is that's mentioned in the body of the Constitution as opposed to the Bill of Rights? It's a very obscure thing, but it's astounding. The right to the patent, to inventions. That, they thought, was a right. The Federalists thought, that's a right you've got to get in the Constitution. So we ask, according to Heidegger, all we should expect from technology as regards democracy is the demise of democratic life. And good riddance, I think we would say. We thus ask, is this what Havel meant? That we should not celebrate too naively about the victory of democracy, because its only real blessing is its power to point us beyond its stultifying technological nihilism. Perhaps Havel has seen what Heidegger predicted. A technological world that subverts its own ontological principles. Perhaps Havel saw that what he predicted really does seem to be at hand, and one could make a case that it's at hand. Consider this. We see a triumphant West, right? The extraordinary global reach of liberal democracy with its restless and unstoppable march of homogenizing technology. At the same time, an aggressive, egalitarian, and leveling relativism is now generally thought to be essential to liberal democracy, just as Heidegger predicted would happen in the age of technological nihilism. And the rationalistic, metaphysical principles at the root of contemporary democracy, the ideal of material progress, the epistemological dignity of the natural sciences, natural rights, the ideals of individual liberty and responsibility, these things really do seem to be approaching exhaustion, at least in some people's eyes. Our world thus could be said to be coming a bit unglued. We live with the political and material benefits of our institutions, while at the same time growing tired of the worldview that was always thought essential for producing and sustaining these institutions. No wonder that Heidegger is attractive to so many liberals and Democrats today. His thought is a plausible explanation for our situation, and it seems to point to the remedy for our dissatisfaction. Now, I would say seems because it's not clear whether the appropriation of Heidegger by modern Democrats is true to Heidegger or good for liberal democracy. Time prevents considering the appropriators of Heidegger in any detail, but let me describe very schematically how I think it's gone. In general, the Heidegger followers fall into two camps: those who use him for the sake of democratizing liberal democracy and those who use him for liberalizing liberal democracy. The democratizers think the technology is undemocratic in its present configuration because it tends to hierarchy, and because by glutting us with trivial and banal pleasures, it blinds us to this indignity of to the indignity of such hierarchy. You know, the poor are glutted with burgers, cheap beer, and okra, and so they don't see what's happening to them. Technology and liberal democracy go hand in hand, not just because the latter requires a rising standard of living, but because liberal democracy does not favor direct political participation and is wedded to the principle of equality of opportunity, which is a not-so-subtle justification for inequality. And technological liberalism is not only unjust, it also produces a kind of life that is not at all attractive: bourgeois philistinism and vulgar consumerism, the world according to Mickey Mouse. But the problem is not just for the democratizers. The problem isn't the material force of technology or the bad character of elitist bosses. It's, in fact, the cause identified by Heidegger, the technological frame of mind, which is rooted in the metaphysical worldview. This view inclines us, so the argument goes, to think of the person as a subject, an isolated individual defined by rights against others, rather than as a rooted, socially constructed self that emerges in the course of political participation. The villain is not the machine, it's metaphysics and the myth of the subject that has been at the heart of Western thinking since Descartes. This view gave us technology, but thanks to the saving power of technology, that is the self-destruction of the metaphysical tradition, we can look forward to gender and liberation from the illusions and distortions of our own intellectual heritage, and thus look forward to genuine democracy based on real community. It's not an accident that this revolution took place in English departments, in philosophy departments. Kill metaphysics. It was once thought that the great transformative event would be the transformation of the working class. Now it's the elimination of metaphysics. On the university campus, metaphysics is responsible for everything, from daybreak to racism. Serious arguments, not the loud arguments, but serious arguments would say that, you get right down to it, it's this, it's a certain habit of totalizing thinking and so on and so forth. Now, much the same argument can be heard from those who would liberalize our liberalism. These include progressives like Richard Rorty and the proliferating adherents of multiculturalism and identity politics. They also reject the myth of the subject and incline toward the principle of group definition of moral and political personality. But they are more liberal than the democratizers because they take the established institutions of modern liberalism, and especially the welfare state, for granted. I'm not the first to point out that the new revolutionaries are quick to run to establish authority for protection, which is an amazing turnaround from the 60s when students wanted to kill the president. Now the students want to run to the president. That's true. And it's amazing. And by the way, European social democrats see this and really get scared. The European social democrats think that Heideggerian-based identity politics is just so much bourgeois quasi-fascist nonsense, justification of the welfare state. But So they have no problem in appealing to the power and authority of the liberal state, but still they see the culprit of our times as metaphysics, or what's called foundationalism. The tendency to think that our institutions require demonstrable theoretical ground. In their eyes, metaphysics, this is Rorty's argument, Richard Rorty's argument, metaphysics leads to absolutism, which leads to exclusivity in the guise of universalism. And all this makes us crabby and judgmental and sexist, racist, Eurocentric, and homophobic. If we give up the tyranny of the Western philosophic tradition, we'll all become more caring and inclusive, and therefore our liberalism will be more genuinely liberal than it is. The argument here is not so much about technology as a thing. They don't talk about this very much. But it is certainly, as it is with the democratizers, but it clearly reflects the Heideggerian argument that technology is the danger that saves by undermining the dogmatics of Western metaphysics. And in the case of Rorty, it's quite clear that Heidegger is the source. And the Heidegger argument on technology is the source. Now, the first thing that comes to mind, if you look back to the Heideggerian origins, to the borrowings from Heidegger, many of which, by the way, are very fruitful, don't get me wrong, politically very fruitful and interesting. The first thing that comes to mind is that from a Heideggerian point of view, these seem themselves to be technological when we compare them to Heidegger taken seriously, or at least as he would take himself, I think. From Heidegger's point of view, technology saves by showing us that our human destiny is not in our control. For him, to think that we can determine our world simply blinds us to our own kind of being, and especially to the genuine meaning of death. The busy preoccupation with doing what can't be done is the dodge that's built into everyday life, and it's the dodge that's at the heart of metaphysics and technology. You know, you could say our whole metaphysical tradition grew up from this productive comportment, and productive comportment is the attempt to make something that isn't there. From that, it's not a far reach to say you can make anything that isn't there. The new liberals and Democrats who make use of Heidegger are oblivious, it seems to me, to this part of the argument. They all assume that overcoming metaphysics is a tool, a thing, you know, it's a weapon that will enable us to fashion the world as we see fit. And Heidegger, I think, would simply say, that's impossible. All assume that nothing should stand in the way of the free-ranging human will. Not nature, not tradition, or the way things happen to be, and surely not the demands of blood and soil. And all, I think all, without exception, favor equality of material conditions, and even more than that, equality of respect. Something that Heidegger would say is shot through with the technological nihilism that simply cannot abide the possibilities of such things as excellence, courage, rank, and difference, genuine difference. In other words, I think Heidegger would say all the talk about difference is really a fear of recognizing what's really different. I mean, one of the reasons we can do that so easily is because we don't have different religions in America that want to kill each other, so you know, our notion of difference is pretty tame. Heidegger's was not. The guiding view of the new liberals and Democrats that are so deeply influenced by Heidegger is that everything should be possible. This is a view, says Heidegger, that has but one result, a busy activism that hides us from the one possibility, which is distinctly our own as human beings, that puts an end to all possibility, and that's death. Now, from this perspective, the contemporary attempts, from a Heideggerian point of view, the contemporary attempts to assimilate Heidegger to liberalism and democracy look like the final stage of technological nihilism. They embody a furious egalitarianism that levels every difference, that makes reverence impossible, that banishes the awesome and the strange. From the Heideggerian point of view, then, it would be possible to see his American Heideggerians, and some of the Europeans as well, as the harbingers of a world so repulsive and disenchanted that it ushers in a new dispensation of being in which equality and the caring will to power have no place at all. If this should happen, it would be a big surprise to the boutique Heideggerians of our time. Now, this isn't to say that Heidegger's views are good for liberal democracy, just because they help us to see, you know, what we're doing, except perhaps to warn us of the awful fate that awaits us. For all the power of his argument and for all its power to illuminate our ills, there still remains the question as to whether we must agree with him that liberal democracy is finished. This is a question that we can't consider here, but should I take a few minutes and make a few remarks about what I think is wrong and why we might not take him too seriously. So let me just suggest a few directions for how I think thinking about these matters might take. Now, Heidegger's complaint against the metaphysical tradition was that it tried to make one kind of thing the standard for everything. That's totalism. Okay? It dogmatically violated the principle that everything is what it is and not something else. That's, by the way, something that is also a fundamental principle of Wittgenstein as well. Wittgenstein and Heidegger didn't know each other, and certainly Wittgenstein didn't meet anybody, so he didn't meet Heidegger, but there's an amazing similarity between the two. The reason it did this, i.e., forget the principle that everything is what it is and not something else, is that it had a view, it had a prejudice, that if one thing didn't rule the world, God, or nature, or moral virtue, or justice, then the world would fly apart. And the various kinds of things would exist not in harmony, but in war with each other. Faith as opposed to reason, theory as opposed to practice, nature as opposed to convention, philosophy as opposed to citizenship, the family as opposed to the polis or the state, and so on. So the domains of being, all the various ways that things can be and happen, were conceived of as elements of the world that are unified in the same way that the causes of a single object are unified as present at hand. And it was done for the obvious reason that, conceived in such a way, the world would be taken to persist always and in the same form. The world is thus the home of the immortal soul. If and when, of course, it is understood by philosophy. Why else do we need to philosophize? The world becomes this when we know it to be what it is. So philosophy in the form of metaphysics grew out of this everyday experience in order to free the world to answer the hopes that arise from everyday experience. According to Heidegger, when all this is broken with technology, we can then experience the various domains of being and the way they cut up our own lives and determine our own lives, and let them occur as they genuinely are, wholly themselves and interacting without being reduced one to the other. Therefore, a genuine difference-preserving unity of human experience is possible, according to him. Science, which studies objects of nature, thought, which studies being as a whole, faith, which turns its faith to the gods, work, which comports itself to artifacts, war and citizenship, which is the aspect of our life having to do with the facts of our public life, all of these things, he says, can be fully compatible with each other and at the same time wholly themselves, not reduced one to the other. Because it will not be thought that they must fit together causally and under the rule of one. That is, they will not be forced to fit together in the distorted way that answers to the everyday dodge of death. Now, I think that Heidegger might be right in his account of the origins of the metaphysical worldview. That, in other words, he might be right that philosophy constitutes our dogmatic tradition arises from the false hopes of everyday life. But it seems to me that he didn't work out in very great detail just how philosophy arises from the hopes and conditions of everyday life. He didn't do this in sufficient detail, and this led him to ignore the political dimension of the political context in which such hopes arise. It's not an accident, therefore, that Heidegger's politics were so monstrous and so wrong. He thus never considered that some philosophy, or what he would call genuine thinking, would perforce be esoteric. that philosophers might tell lies. Now, I would suggest that a way of getting at this is to think somehow a little bit differently. The world is thought of metaphysically and causally, not just because men fear death. Rather, it is thought in this way because we fear death and love justice. These two modes of human comportment are very closely related. In avoiding the terror of death, human beings are inclined to think that they can do something about it, that if they are just, the world or the heavens will care for them and reward them. This is rooted in the moral intuitions of everyday life and related to the agency involved in what Heidegger correctly views as the productionist orientation of average everyday life. By our art and our behavior, we free or liberate a world that cares for us. The fear of death and the love of justice, both are immediately and reciprocally related in the following way. Being just is how we turn the world to our account. And since being just always requires the sacrifice of one's good to one degree or another, a world that cares for us eventually or eternally because of what we do is an inevitable part of the everyday world. But justice sets the parts of any political order at odds, because people aren't equal, because there's an inevitable divide between the rich and the poor, between the weak and the strong, and between the common good and the goods that are simply one's own. At the same time, the justice calls for an authoritative common good. So the love of justice, enlisting and enlisted by the fear of death, is an inescapable functional requirement of political life. It invariably interprets the world and the elements of human experience as composed of potentially conflicting parts and a saving, ruling principle to be discovered by thought. It thus simply cannot be expected that public life will ever be free of the metaphysical conception of being and the causal unity of being. It can never be expected that politics will be free of the compulsion to discover a commanding common good that orders the conflicting aspects of human experience. It will thus be impossible, it seems to me, to see the end of the distortions of metaphysics. And so we can never expect, as Heidegger did, that genuine thought can ever determine an era. It's never the case, as he argued, that work and war and thinking and faith can harmoniously and perfectly live together without a commanding or managing order. That's just not possible, I would say. There will always be an unbridgeable divide between the most genuine thought and the historical destiny of any age. So it might be that Heidegger is quite wrong about the fate of liberal democracy, because the conflicts that this regime is designed to manage, between the rich and the poor, and between religion and politics, and morality and justice, and private and public life, and so on, will always call for a ruling principle, not because of metaphysics and liberalism, but because any form of everyday life is first and foremost political as well as productive. Politics gives rise to metaphysics, not the other way around. And liberalism was designed to take that fact into account. So I think that it would be good for liberals and Democrats not to become too enchanted by the likes of Heidegger, whose political judgment was utterly distorted by his understanding of being in the world. And it's important for us, I think, to reflect on the reasons why today so many liberals and Democrats, including Vaclav Havel, look to Heidegger for their moral and political bearings. That's it. I apologize for keeping you so long, but I'll be happy to stick around as long as you want and answer some questions if there are any. Heidegger is like being having a bath of a big tub of water dumped on your head. Are there any? Yes, please.
So, do you think John Muir and Ralph Nader are right that we ought to be really wary of technology and put lots of regulations on it and not let it get out of hand?
Oh, sure. Yeah, no, I would agree. Oh, of course, yeah. But, you know, it's very odd that... Oh, go ahead.
That's okay.
Yeah, I would say so, yeah, because Sure, because, I mean, I don't agree with Heidegger that there isn't a problem of ordering and, you know, technology is not a power that comes from God or metaphysics. It is something to do, and we can do it to our detriment. Now, I would further argue, however, that, I mean, in my own view, I'm inclined to think that that liberal regimes that are addicted to comfort. I mean, if you think, what is the principle of American democracy since Hobbes? I mean, self-preservation, what he calls commodious living. Okay? If that's true, then the one regime that has as its fundamental guiding principle is not the rape of nature, as many critics of liberalism, the deep ecologists, for instance, seems to be, really do think that they agree with Heidegger. They bought this argument. Technology and democracy, hand in hand, and both are utterly uncontrollable. Okay? I mean, they will rape the planet. And in Heidegger's case, he thought rape was a great thing because it wakes us up. So he's saying, yeah, let's see technology proceed to a fevered pitch, and then it'll show us who we are.
But if that's true, then isn't it also true though that the most democratic nations are also the most advanced in curbing technology?
Oh, no, that's my point. That's exactly my point. My point is that the deep ecologists buy Heidegger's argument. I think it's false. The simple principle, and for a very simple commonsensical reason, our regime is not based on the love of conquest. I mean, in its deepest philosophical principles, when you read Hobbes and Locke and all these people, they describe people as fearful. Fear is the passion to be counted on. Comfort is the passion to be counted on. There's nowhere in any doctrine, in any documents of liberal democratic philosophy where the conquering hero is praised. That's the stuff of Greek poetry, but not us. And so our regime is, in principle, dedicated to comfort and safety. I mean, we're safety nuts. You know, only in America could people become terrified of apples. You know, I mean, terrified of apples. There was an apple scare, remember? Alar, right? You know, people, you know, a Roman would look at us and say, what? You know, frightened of an apple? Are you, what kind of, you know, the depraved, weak creatures are you? So we're fearful, and we seek comfort, and therefore we're not going to foul our nests. You know, not inevitably, not permanently. The reason that democracies don't foul are the best cleaner-uppers is because they are not only politically good at it, because they have avenues for people to bring suit against polluters and all of that, but because it's in their bones to worry about health and safety. It's just in their bones to worry about long life and commodious living. So Heidegger was just wrong about that, and the ecologists who buy into him are wrong about that. And I would say that the ecologists who are Heidegger, you know Arne Naess. Arne Naess is the great guru of deep ecology, and there's a whole bunch of them at Humboldt State in California and all over, and they believe that it's not based on careful preservation. It's based on the idea that human beings are bad because they're driven by this Western technological mindset to destroy the world, and therefore that has to be stopped. Yeah.
But when you say ecologists, I mean they're also the Sierra Club ecologists.
Oh sure, no.
Lobbyists in Washington.
Yeah. Of course. No, that's a different issue altogether. Yeah, yeah. But deep ecology, which was once a very powerful movement, and one thing about the ecology movement is how fast it disappeared. I'm really quite amazed. You know, I thought that ecology would be a big political force in Europe and in America, and it isn't. It's just amazing. The Green parties are struggling. I mean, really, it's sort of petered out as a big political issue. I'm not saying it will go away, but certainly the revolutionary ecologists in Germany and in America thought that, boy, this is it. This, you know, we have found the fundamental contradiction in capitalism. It's not the workers. It's not the fettering of the means of production. it's the limited capacity of the earth to put up with what this regime depends on in principle. And so that was, you know, that was the fundamental contradiction. I'm not sure that's correct. And Heidegger was not so good about that. I mean, to follow up on that question in a different way, I think that in a way that the Heideggerian question of technology and the idea that ending metaphysics is the metaphysic, that this way of thinking, this technological way of thinking from before, we grew up in Descartes' time and completely dominant in ours, is the real villain, and that has to be changed. And that's not the only reason, but that's some of what's going on in all the culture wars, I think. There's one argument about diversity, which is a perfectly easy argument. Then there's a deeper argument about that grows out of Nietzsche and Heidegger, which is, no, this is really fundamental stuff. This is the end of the West, we know it, that sort of stuff. And that's what a lot of the culture wars, I think, is. Heidegger did not succumb to a metaphysical understanding of philosophy. I would just simply excuse that. But the reason they got that argument is because Heidegger made that argument about himself. And he made it about himself after the war. I hate to say this, but Heidegger is the greatest thinker of our time. He's also the slimiest character that philosophy has ever seen. He was a real liar. And a bad man. And he lied like mad about his own views when it came time to describe why he made this political choice. So when asked by the denazification police, why did you do this? He said, metaphysics made me do it. He did. It was technology that made me do it. I was in the grip of this, and I didn't see clearly through it. There's all kinds of evidence in the early writings, especially the unpublished writings, that he knew exactly to what extent and to what extent not his writings presumed metaphysical presupposition. I'm giving a kind of a historical answer, which I know isn't adequate, but it's a shorter one. Derrida bought this. Because it gave him an excuse for Heidegger, because he was a great defender of Heidegger. And Heidegger told it because he wanted his job back. Okay? I just don't buy that argument. It all depends on one's reading of Being and Time, and I think it's wrong. Yeah. I think it's really wrong. But Heidegger makes no commitment. And I think that the whole argument is a tempest in a teapot because of this really bizarre circumstance. His French defenders, and then it was Hannah Arendt took this argument up. That was the argument of the totalitarianism studies and the banality of evil argument. So this argument became very powerful in the early 60s. And it was cover for Heidegger, because he did this terrible thing, and he wanted his job back, and he could think of no better explanation for it. And if you think about his discussion of technology, that's the proof of the pudding, because although he told this to the investigators, and the gullible students, if you read the technology stuff, I think, just carefully enough, you see that he's saying that technology is the present dispensation of the revealing of things. It's possible to understand the present dispensation of the revealing of things, okay, without succumbing to them. Okay? It's clearly possible that he's doing it. Moreover, I'm not at all convinced that his politics required I think that Heidegger was also a great opportunist, and he saw that, you know, his philosophy, being what it was certainly not inimical to the, it was certainly not utterly contrary to the National Socialist policy, but he knew how to talk and to make it sound like it was, and he thought he would become its leader, its ruler. It's a rare academic who could pass up the chance, you know, of having a philosophy that suddenly rings a few bells that the president likes. You know, look how fast they flocked to Washington. It would have been harder to resist that in Germany. So that's what he did. He just made it all up, a lot of that stuff. Why it had to be this crazy historicist nationalist stuff, I'm not sure that it follows from that. In other words, one could read through reading the time and follow it out rigorously, and it would not necessarily result in the embrace of this crazy political party. It wouldn't. So I think that was extraneous. That's a weird position for me to be, because that's an exoneration of Heidegger's philosophy in a way, at least in his case. Now, the one thing that I think is very dangerous, Heidegger, as a matter of historical fact, Heidegger was attracted to the socialist part of the Nazi movement. You know, we all forget that National Socialism was socialism. They weren't embarrassed by that fact. It was National Socialism, it was socialism nevertheless. And therefore, there is one way in which Heidegger's genuine views about what life would be like with a society, what a society would be like based on a genuine understanding of the world. And it is this possible harmony of the realms of life, this kind of harmony within perfect difference, this idea that war, faith, and all, you know, everything can be fully itself and at the same time not fly apart, not need totalizing principles that subordinate one to the other, as, for instance, liberalism does. Our regime is not dedicated to war. You know, we forget, you know, ask George Bush, you know, they get forgotten as soon. Imagine winning such a war in a warlike society and then being forgotten 6 months later. It really kind of tells us something about ourselves. So in a liberal society, war is a necessity, but it's an unpleasant thing that only yokels get roped into by smart, rich people to do, something like that. But here you have this notion that, you know, all the various aspects of human life can be utterly full in and of themselves and cohere together with the parts of the community. That's something that liberalism cannot accept. It cannot accept. And nor can any of the sort of traditional regime understandings, but that is something that is characteristic of a certain kind of utopian socialism, a certain kind of goofy totalitarianism. And that's the basis, that was where Heidegger saw the net, the hook. Politics is very dangerous. And anybody who buys that stuff, be careful with it. It's so popular these days, it's like having a cobra for a pet, I would say.
So what do you consider the status of American liberalism today? I mean, having a hard time understanding your reference to Hobbes at all.
That's a good question. What he thought was this. Havel, I think Havel Mill, you know, this is one thing that's been characteristic of Eastern European dissidents when they come here and they look around. They love, you know, they love us, and they love the West, but they come and they say, secretly, they say, you're sick. You know, what? How did you ever manage to defend yourself? You know, you're Solzhenitsyn, for instance, gets invited to Harvard and gives it and calls these people pansies. I mean, it was just something. And you're all weak. You know, you have no religion. Everything's the same. You all you do is go to Disneyland and eat hamburgers. You know, with a certain dripping contempt. And Havel, I think, feels the same way. Okay. And what he thought was something like this: there really is a kind of, I mean, one of the things they're appalled at is they know as intellectuals that American intellectuals for a long time apologized for the regime that hurt them so much. I mean, they know this, and they can't understand how it's possible, you know. So they're inclined to think your regime did well, but your thinkers are crazy. And your thinkers are now influencing the general culture, and Heidegger is the genuine source of that. Okay? So now, in Havel's case, he thought that, yes, we have to come to grips with Heidegger, because what he said is true in much of what he said is simply true, that in a liberal society like ours, whose in a sense, fundamental principles begin to wane. Eventually, they do wane, and especially, I think, a super aggressive egalitarian relativism is, in a lot of these dissidents' view, a dangerous thing. It's a very dangerous thing, not because they care about, you know, religion or because they're absolutists, but they look at this from a cold political sense, and they say, wait, if you believe these things, you're never going to be able to defend yourself. You won't learn how to work, you know, things like that. I mean, you'll not be able to tell the difference between what's important and what's banal. Your culture will become utterly despicable. And I think what Heidegger said is that what comes after that is religion. In fact, that's what he said. What comes next is a new god. Okay? And that's what I think that Havel may have meant. That the West has won, but the West is in some kind of danger because it no longer believes the principles that it took for granted. Who on earth in an American university believes in natural rights, or would admit to believing in them? I mean, if you're running for Supreme Court, you better not admit it. Okay, right? Natural law. You know, when what's his face was running, they talked about natural law as if that was witchcraft. Okay. Well, the founders didn't. I personally believe the founders didn't believe in natural law, but they said they did, and they thought it was absolutely essential to say to do. Okay. I think that's I think Havel would say something like this: can you imagine a present American generation or a present American polity fighting a war and losing 1.5 million of its citizens to free slaves? I think they would all say, of course not. It's unthinkable. Because not enough people believe in God in the right way for that to happen. I think that's, you know. So it's along those lines that Heidegger is very relevant, because he points out all these things that if you read him carefully, you look around, you say, really, you know, there's something to all this. There really is. Okay? And then can a culture long survive when it no longer believes in the fundamental principles upon which it was always based? So I think the answer is we could be in the long future, and if you take Heidegger seriously, we could be in for some pretty dark and nasty possibilities. Who knows what kind of craziness will arise, you know? What kind of love of the dark and the strange and the terrifying lurks in the hearts of human beings. Heidegger, one of the attractions of Heidegger is he's always talking about being able to re-enchant the world. You know, that comes from, you know, Max Weber and Nietzsche, all of this, is that philosophers are going to re-enchant the world. This is very modern, by the way, the idea that philosophy can fix the world. But What does it mean to re-enchant the world? You know, what is this? Who wants to live in such a world? Does it have, you know, what kind of gods populate this world?
So we should we retreat back to some sort of foundationalism? Should many people think about
I have no answer to that question. I really couldn't answer that question because should we retreat to it? That's like saying should we change the course of, you know, the seas or something. I'm not sure. I mean, if I could, I probably would. Yeah, it'd be a good idea. Yeah. But, you know, these things are difficult and how can we blame these things? Yeah. But let me put it this way. It's a good idea to be prepared in some way for what's coming. And it's, at least if it's not a good idea, it's interesting.
So the future's not so bright.
If Heidegger is right, it's not. Yeah. If he's right, it's not. And it's not your future, it's quite a few generations away. And it's possible that this could happen without us knowing it, too. It's possible that we could become such slugs that we don't even realize it. You know, like Nietzsche talks about, you know, being polluted. Yeah.
I'm curious how exactly these words don't play around, but I'm wondering how Heidegger is perceived to put it back. It seems like there's some indications that you believe in the God, perhaps that's pure. Right?
Well, he said things like that. I mean, he really makes it pretty obvious.
But in context of this interpretation of Heidegger's view of the world.
Sure. He did believe for a time that the National Socialist Party was in fact, the Nazis were a youth party. Okay, they were a nature party. They were a revolutionary party. Okay, I remember in my student, there was a lot of similarity between Nazism and the New Left in the 60s youth days. The young community. We've got to put an end to the reifications of liberalism, to the reifications of industrial organization, and on and on and on, to get back genuine community, right? Genuine and authenticity, in fact. I mean, that's straight out of Being in Time, you know, that somehow one has to be authentically in tune with one's generational heritage, okay? I think rock and roll can be understood in some extent like that too. It's a very it's generationally narcissistic music. As much as I like it, that's what it is. And it means that it tells you that what's yours is good. What's yours is good. Okay? And what happens because it's yours is good. Okay? And that may be not such a healthy political point of view when it's taken from extremes, and especially when you think that the traditional institutions that, in a sense, you know, at a very homely and everyday, you know, workaday way, sort of keep us out of each other's hair. When you come to think of those institutions as somehow the fundamental causes for all that's wrong in the world, you know, that's a cause for some concern, I think. And that does grow out of Heidegger. It really does. Yeah. It really does. Yeah.
Just have a question. I may have missed something that you said about this. I'm not familiar with Heidegger's metaphysics. I'm assuming for the moment that he thought, he didn't think that God or gods exist.
He's a bit fuzzy on this, okay? He talks about the divine things and the gods. But the one thing missing from him is the one thing missing from almost all the moderns. Proof, you know?
But the awareness that the proof is missing is not always missing from the moderns.
Yeah, right. It's not missing from him either. I mean, he fudges with this. I must admit to being quite perplexed about what he means by gods. You know, is this something that tells you what to do?
Well, let me put the question this way.
Yeah.
Did he think that why would he have thought that Orthodox Christianity, for example, shouldn't be returned to?
Oh,
evidently that wasn't.
Yeah, right. Yeah, because Orthodox Christianity is false as regards an account of what the world is and what human beings.
Now, how does he know that?
Yeah,
how does he think?
Yeah, yeah. By way of his account of what it means to be a created thing. So, if by saying that the Orthodox Christian notion of the world, of the human being, is a created thing that has a nature, a physis, okay? And he simply says, I can show you why, so it takes the whole first half of being time, why this is wrong, why it doesn't explain enough about human experience. So, but there's no proof, you see, I mean, the one thing that isn't there is something like this. What would Heidegger say? Well, in a way, well, let me back up and put it in a different tack. This is, in a way, not unlike perhaps what happens in some Socratic dialogues. In other words, Heidegger says, no, I won't try to prove whether there is or isn't a God. What I'll show you is that what he says, you couldn't believe if I explained it to you fully. Okay? You wouldn't believe it, or you'd have to stop thinking in order to believe it. You'd have to say, I won't listen to this argument. Okay? And that, you know, that's sort of like what, in some ways, that reminds me of, you know, the kind of path that Socrates
would be exactly. Can you give me an example of something that he said we wouldn't believe if he were to give us an account of that?
Yeah, that life is that human existence is radically indeterminate in some sense. That to be human is already to be around things. So he would say that the account of the creation just doesn't concur with our conception of what it means to be a human being located in the world.
And do you think that would be really adequate?
Oh, I don't. I can't believe that he thought that would convince a non-believer. I mean, a believer, no.
But he thought this was convincing even to a sensible person?
To him, it was, yeah.
That's all it took.
Oh, no. I mean, that's what's absent there. I mean, there's no attempt, it seems, to refute the simple-minded, you know, not, I don't mean simple-minded, but, you know, the naive believer. Yeah. There's just no attempt. Yeah. And that's a big weakness. Yeah.
Okay. If there are one more question on the perception.
Whatever. Yeah, I would agree with you, by the way, that while the moderns are quiet about this, they know they're quiet about it. And I'm just not sure if Heidegger knows he's being quiet about it.
Thank you very much.